brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, I don't know what this world is coming to.
Welcome to Brutally Honest Talk Radio.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Let's go, Brandon. Let's go, Brandon. Let's go, Brandon. Let's go, Brandon.
Oh boy, welcome to Brutally Honest Talk Radio. That was Elmo, the conservative. And I am Inger. And welcome to this week. Hope you've had a good week so far. Hope it can only get better from here. What's on tap for us today?
Oh, we got a few good things. We got a good show. So the main thing we're going to talk about is Joe Biden announcing that he's going to appoint a black woman to the Supreme Court. He hasn't decided yet. There are no candidates, as he's said, but that is for certain. Whoever it is going to be a woman and is going to be black. Talking about Biden, right? He gave this speech within the last week, and he lists all these things. He said they're going to be qualified and uphold the Constitution, whatever. And then at the end of it, he canceled out everything that he said before by saying, but I can assure you the person is going to be black and they're going to be a woman.
Yes, he did that.
You saw that. Mm-hmm. And some black people are okay with this. And our thinking, our mentality is we want to see black folks in everything. Mm-hmm. We just like seeing us taking over stuff, running stuff, wearing the black gown, the robe, being a part of the Supreme Court, because we still have an affirmative action mentality. Put us in it. Let us take over. You just, you know, put some rainbow sprinkles on it. It's a Crayola box of crayons. We need a variety. And qualifications don't matter, but the Supreme Court, they rule on issues that affect everyone, affect the entire nation. And if there was something that went to the Supreme Court and the justice that was ruling on it, regardless of their race, if it was affecting you, and I'm talking to the audience, if it's affecting you, you want the way that they are ruling, you want it to be in your favor or lining up with your beliefs. And if they rule against the way that you want them to rule, the fact that it's a woman or that it's a black person, whether it be Clarence Thomas or this forthcoming woman, you won't care about that at all. You know, black people who are okay with abortion, want abortion to be legal. This is just an example, because I'm against abortion. You know, I mean, as anybody doesn't already know, I'll come out and say that. You know, there are minuscule exceptions to the rule, but overall, I'm against it. So just as an example, if there's a black woman who is liberal or a Democrat voter, whatever, and she is for abortion, which is now legal. She doesn't want Roe v. Wade to be overturned. She wants it to stay the way that it is. And the woman who is your role model that looks the way that you want her to look, that inspires little black girls to grow up and be proud and all of that, none of that's going to matter. None is going to matter when she brings the gavel down and hits it on a desk and said, this is how I'm ruling on this. So we need to stop playing Mr. Dress Up and playing, stage plays and sitcom. We need to stop doing that.
Yeah, so. I definitely agree. Folks are under the wrongful impression that just because somebody looks like you, that they agree with you on everything that you do. Or not even on everything, on 50% of what you agree on. And that's just not true. So the idea that just because somebody looks like me, that we share the same values is stupid. It's just plain dumb. And, you know, for Joe Biden and to take this in another direction, and it was on my Facebook page and it sparked some interest, definitely. For Joe Biden to say, I'm going to choose a black woman. Well, how do we know she's most qualified? You can't prove that she's the most qualified. Why? Because you eliminated 98% of the people out there. So, you know, by saying that, it's just, I don't know that he's getting the most qualified. I can't say he is. I can't say he isn't, because I don't have anything else to compare her to. And I think that's just, again, the height of, just because somebody is in that spot and they look a certain way, then that qualifies them. I thought we'd gone past this.
Yeah,
I thought we were done. What happened to content of their character? What happened to that?
Right. Yeah.
So, and you know, Joe Biden did the same thing with his running mate, saying she either had to be a black person or a woman. That's what he was going for. So again, you're eliminating people based upon the color of their skin, their ethnicity, and their genitalia. So I think that's just it's ridiculous. Again, Democrats doing what Democrats do. And you know, separating people according to features, instead of character. So
and also homeboys, homeland. You may not look very much like me, but because we come from the same place, because our roots were pulled up out of the same ground. Your family, your homie, that's what we want, you know. That's who we want in there. And it takes away from the integrity and the authenticity of black people for us to want this. And anybody who says, I want to see somebody black on the Supreme Court, if you really want that, I mean, if it's really important to you, you go to law school and you be qualified to be that person. Earn it. Show it. Show that we're not one-dimensional people standing in the welfare line looking for a handout. Show that you're qualified. I mean, be that person or raise your children up, you know, if that's really what you want. And also, anybody who says that they want a black person on the Supreme Court, a black woman, name that woman. Give me the name of that woman who exists now. Who is that? Who do you want him to pick? Who?
Right.
Because identity politics is really bad.
It really is. And it's a shame it's really hit the Supreme Court as well. And I'm going to go back to something you said, which was very interesting. You said it's like folks standing in the welfare line. Well, that's just kind of, I know whoever he chooses is going to be smart, whatever. But it's like, oh, I need to give you a handout so you can, so I can bring you here. You need a handout. You need a handout. Instead of saying, I'm going to choose the best person qualified or the best person who I think is qualified. Hopefully they'll get through the Senate nomination or the Senate hearings and come out of the other end. And, oh, by the way, she happens to be a black woman. Oh, okay. It's like, oh, boy, you know, that should be like, oh, my gosh, she's so smart. And she's a black woman. Oh, my gosh. Right.
A very secondary thing that you notice later, like someone's eye color or their height, or, you know, their accent or whatever. Just a very background thing.
Yes.
And, you know, there used to be a time 20 or 30 years ago when being a token black was shameful. Like, nobody wanted to be a token.
That's true. Feeling
now we're at the Franklin Mint making huge tokens the size of manhole covers, going, give me my token. I need to be recognized for who I is. Y'all see my blackness, don't you? Well, today I want you to see it. Tomorrow I don't want you to see it.
Right. Right. Exactly. Yeah. That was a,
You know what I'm saying? Well, people used to be like, if I'm going to be a part of where there's a country club that played golf, or was the workplace, or whether you were on the NASA team to go in space, because the Challenger space shuttle that blew up and that black man who was on there, he was qualified.
Yes.
He was a brilliant scientist, astronaut.
He was.
I'm talking about he could tie calculus and astrophysics and all this stuff into pretzels.
Yeah. Yes. And this was Ron McNair. Yep.
You can't be up there in orbit screwing around. No. You don't know what you're doing.
At all.
You know what I mean?
At all. That is so true.
So that's one thing that needs to flip, and we need to go back to it. I don't want to be part of a bean counter.
Yes.
Well, you know, we need another brown person in here. Yeah, I mean, you take pride in that.
Yes.
So that's what that is.
And it should be diversity. You know, everybody's into diversity, inclusion, you know, the flavor of the, it seems like the last 5-10 years instead of the flavor of the month. But they're looking at people, oh, you're diverse, you're diverse, you look different, you're a different gender, you're a different ethnicity, all that sort of stuff. What about diversity of thought? You know,
yeah,
I think that's the most valuable diversity there is, diversity of thought. So you're getting different opinions, different perspectives, different viewpoints on an issue, which will hopefully inform the final decision. So,
and that's what your individuality is. Mm-hmm. That's what makes anger, mm-hmm. is how she thinks differently from other people.
Exactly.
For the most part, that's, mm-hmm. that's who you are, is your thoughts and how you live your life. And your ideas make you unique. Your ideas describe and represent your heart. They come from your heart and your mind. Mm-hmm. That's who your soul is.
Yes.
And we're human beings. We're not animals. We have souls.
Yes.
And God created each of us individually.
Yes, he did.
Right? And it's been a long time since this happened, right? Unheard of for this generation.
Mm-hmm.
Is they found out in a national poll that most people 18 to 24 years old, all races, do not like Biden or Harris.
Wow. 18 to 24,
which usually that's the young, rebellious, change the world, liberal, yes. go with the left, go with the Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
And we know what's going on, you know, in college campuses across the country.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the majority of 18 to 24, and Even liberals. I'm not talking about people who are conservative. I'm mm-hmm. talking about people who usually or otherwise would have voted for the Democrat candidate or supported them. They don't like Biden or Harris.
Wow. Interesting.
And that lines up with, I said last week, you know, last week's episode about their approval ratings being like 28% and 34%. Which even, you know, it's always going to be off a little margin mm-hmm. of error. But even if it's off by 10 points, that's still way below half the country.
Yes.
You know, is approving whatever they're doing, whatever.
Wow. So. Interesting. And usually, like I said, that age, anything goes, you're just... You know everything, and this is how it should be. And you, like you say, you want to change the world. And it's interesting. I would like to know where they're leaning. If they don't like them, where are they leaning? Is it Bernie? Is it AOC? Is it Trump? Is it like, where are they going?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like as a conservative, there may be some Republican candidates that are running that I don't care for, you know, even though I am conservative. But there can be an idiot that gets up there who they don't make good decisions, or I'm not really feeling them. So I think that's kind of the thing.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know. I don't know what miracle they can pull out of a hat. If they run in 2024 against mm-hmm. Trump, because Trump is running again, then I still don't know if their hatred for Trump would still be so great that they would still not vote for Trump.
Right.
However, you're going to have 4 years that go by with a track record where you're tracking all kind of stuff into the house, all kind of mess.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to hang themselves. That's what I think. It's still got to be more support for Trump and less support for Biden than it was at the beginning. And, yes. and I was thinking about this the other day. It would behoove CNN and the people that work there for Trump to get back in. That's good for business.
Right. It helps their ratings.
Yeah, right.
But they can manage to keep their people from sleeping with each other and everybody else. That would be real nice.
Having sleepovers and underage and producers and, you know.
Yeah.
Really. All kind of stuff. Yeah. But, right. just mm-hmm. like looking on paper and black and white, like the bottom line is business mm-hmm. and making money. It makes them more money. I mean, we're talking about people canceling CNN and subscribers going away and getting their news elsewhere and just losing an interest. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they got those ratings by lying. So, I don't want them to do that. But, I'm thinking for business. But mm-hmm. they're more caring about and more concerned about the social justice warrior and the soft Jimmy Carter type that's gonna come in there and just stroke everybody and let's have some warm milk and go to sleep and the snowflakes are falling outside and everything's gonna be nice. And when you wake up in the morning, there will be clean cold technology and hybrid vehicles.
There you go. On their way to utopia. Yes, that's what they're looking for.
Yeah. Now I'm willing to start a GoFundMe for the ship that's going to sail to utopia. We can take all the liberals, put them on this ship. We can call it Mayflower 2. Put them on there and send it out southeast toward Bermuda.
Right.
Toward Bermuda. Yeah.
Gosh.
And, and wish them the best.
Yeah. Happy trails.
All right. So check this out. And if you're not already familiar with him, you know him when you hear his voice, if not see his face. Stephen A. Smith, who has been, through the whole thing, through Floyd and the pandemic and just the coming against Trump and Republicans over the last few years, found this video that popped up with him speaking these words that will make you look at the calendar and wonder if it's April Fool's Day. All right, so check this.
All right.
Stephen A. said that every black person in America should vote Republican for at least one election. Stephen A. Smith is joining me now. Stephen, who are you trying to send a message to? Republicans, Democrats, African Americans, all of the above?
I'd go with all of the above. That sounds about right. But specifically the Democratic Party, from the standpoint that I definitely believe that the black vote has been taken for granted. And primarily the black community is at fault, in my estimation, in that regard, simply because on one hand, we're giving one party our vote because they've successfully gone about the business of convincing our community that the other party, the Republican Party, is completely against the interest of the black community. And as a result, we've been very transparent in our support. We've boarded hook, line, and sinker. We look at the Republican Party. I'm not talking about every single one of us, of course, but vast majority of black Americans look at the Republican Party as the enemy. We look at the Democratic Party, even tacitly, as our support base. And as a result, we are very transparent in our support for them. So because of it, they have a license to take us for granted. The Republican Party has a license to summarily dismiss us because they believe they'll never get our vote anyway. And then we end up finding ourselves devoid of any kind of representation whatsoever because nobody is really competing to garner our vote and our support. So I said what I said because I wanted folks in my community to stand up and recognize that if you go to a house or you go buy a car or whatever the case may be, you don't just see something you want and say, I want that. Tell me what the price is and I'll pay for it. Somebody has to flatter you. in order to garner your dollars and your support. I think the same should apply to politicians who represent us.
Let me put this in the context of 2016, because I think given the monolithic nature of the African-American vote, a lot of Republicans don't even make the ask. Rand Paul is making the ask. Is there anything that he can say that you think can change this equation?
Well, first of all, he can highlight some of the inconsistencies and discrepancies the opposing party might be throwing in our direction, things that we may not know. That's number one. Number two, one of the things that you need to do as a Republican, particularly if you're running for the presidency, you have to surround yourself with a bunch of folks that look like us and not just you, that look like Hispanics and not just you.
All right. So, you already know, I disagree with the last part that he said.
Yeah.
Again, you want to do that. They need to be qualified, and they need to, you know, we talk about politicians. They need to believe what you believe and support your agenda. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing. Here's the kicker and the twist. That video was recorded 2015.
Okay. Okay.
All right. We know the election where Trump won was in 2016.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. And most of the hatred for him came in after he got elected, after he got in there. And I think the reason is because he was discounted and they didn't think he was going to win.
Right, right. Yeah, they were pushing Hillary.
You know what I'm saying? Right. By this time, by 2015, we already heard Hillary's rhetoric.
Yes.
And black people, well, you know, most of the country, well, not most of the country, but almost half the country wasn't very excited about what she was saying or what she was supposed to do. No. So then all hell broke loose after he got in there, mm-hmm. especially when he started doing a good job and working on 3-4 tasks a day, getting up 5 o'clock in the morning, going to bed at midnight or whatever.
Yes.
And he was getting so much done. They said, we need to attack him with everything we got, land, sea, and air.
Yeah.
Because we don't want him to get reelected.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the biggest points also is that in 2019 or 2020, Stephen Smith would not have said that.
Okay.
He would not have said, reelect Trump or vote Republican.
Gotcha. Well, it's interesting. I'm kind of tired of folks saying, well, you need to ask the black folks to vote for you. You need to ask the black folks, like we're kids, like we're children, you know, black folks take responsibility. You vote for what you've already always voted for, and you'll get what you've always gotten. You know, you haven't gotten anything. You haven't gotten anywhere. Try something different. And Sandy is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. So, you know, I'm kind of, I put this back on black folks too. Again, you want to know different, you want different, you got to do different, you know. And there's so much information here in your hand with the freaking smartphone. Look up, you know, learn for yourself, that sort of thing. Secondly, we're only maybe 12-13% of the population, and we've been that way for the last 50 years at least, if not more. Yeah. So if we don't vote for Democrats or if we don't vote for Republicans, is it really that big a deal? I mean, honestly, it shouldn't be, because we're so few of the population. I mean, there are pockets of us in different places, but as a whole, there are probably more Hispanics than there are black folks
there will be
soon, by just on sheer numbers. So, you know, enough of this. Y'all, you need to come and ask for the black vote. You need to have a black person standing there next to you. Where else is this conversation being had? What other nationalities are having this conversation? Are Asians? Are Indians? Are Latinos? No, it's just black folks. So why do we have to be the children in the room for this? Grow up, go out and talk to these candidates, talk to these people, go to the party headquarters or whatever, ask questions, look up on your phone, ask questions, you know, get involved, learn, that sort of thing. So, and I totally get what he's saying from 2015, 2016. I totally get what he's saying. But at some point, you got to take responsibility for yourself, put on your clothes like grown men and women, and start acting like grown men and women and not children. So that's my little rant in according
to good. You know. Yeah, and then also I don't want to be patronized. I don't want them to come around the black church just 1 year out of a four-year period.
Exactly.
With you come around because you looked over your shoulder and you asked your advisor, hey, where are the black people hanging out at? But it's gotta be somewhere safe.
Right.
Oh, I know. Church.
Yes.
They're not going to come to the hood and walk down the street and you know, set up barricades or whatever. And then when they do that, they don't have anything to say.
The same stuff. Hillary with hot sauce in her pocket. You know, I ain't no ways tired in the church. You know, Al Gore sitting there trying to act like a black, quote unquote, black preacher, getting all emotional, changing your words, all that sort of stuff. Like you just said, patronizing and pandering. Yeah. You know, we don't need that. That's enough.
Right.
It doesn't make sense. Yeah. And I forgot to do something when we first came on. Don't forget to subscribe to us if you want to hear more dialogue like this us being brutally honest. So hit the like button on YouTube, hit the subscribe button so you'll know when a new episode is uploaded. And also follow us Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Rumble, and the like. Okay, got that in. So go ahead.
Thank you. All right, and I mentioned a few minutes ago about the black church, so I guess that's a good transition to go to this, and I'll explain what I'm getting to. So the N-word, right, which has been attached to and a stigma for black people, which the word was created and used before black people were here and before we were slaves. Mm-hmm. And the word means a low-life person. Low life, lazy, the kind of person is gonna bring things down, make things worse. And black people we were called that name for so long that when we got in our own communities, we started calling each other that because we believed that was our name.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Like we adopted it. And we're too comfortable with it. So, you know, black people know this. There are many from every generation that still use that word. So let me ask you all this. If that's okay and the context is cool, you know, it's got a different definition when we use it. Why is it that no black people use the N-word in church? In the black church where everybody's black and the preacher's black. And this is where we can be ourselves and loosen up and open up and use our culture. You know, why isn't a preacher using it from the pulpit? Now, I did hear Farrakhan say it when he was talking to his congregation one day and he got real mad. This is on YouTube. And he was going off because of the way, you know, the behavior of the members of the church and the ministry outside of the mosque or the other days of the week, right? The way they carry themselves and the way they're interacting with each other. And Farrakhan said, I cut all these bow tie wearing niggas out of here. And, you know, I mean, this is his people and they're listening to him and they're rearing back and they're going, ooh, you know, and he was chastising the women or not being clean and, you know, they're not their dresses and just, you know, different things. Mm-hmm. So that's the only time I've ever heard that. But in the black church, when it's not on TBN or BET and the cameras are turned off, let me say this, not even black Christians, black people who attend church.
Yeah. Yeah.
The annual people that only go on Easter, the street thugs, when they go to church, they don't use the N-word.
Yeah.
So ask yourselves why that is. Why that is. And my thought after thinking about it for a while is because even the people who use it think of it as a curse word and a dirty word.
Yes. Yes.
Even if it's used to reach out to our brethren and our people and show, you know, sign of affection or whatever. We know that we think of it as a bad word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know why, like you said, and that's an interesting observation that you made, is not said in the quote unquote black churches. It is not, it's not used. It's not, it's just, you just don't say that. But yet and still, if you get into the parking lot or folks are now on Monday, they're talking to each other. They're using that word back and forth, back and forth. It's like either you're going to let the word go, or you're going to let people use it how they want to. I mean, because to say that, and I know you've heard this too, oh, that word, when one black person says it to another black person, it's affection, that sort of thing. But when a white person says it to a black person, oh, then that's all of a sudden the dynamics of that word changes. Either use the word or don't use the word. And I have spoken to people I know, when they've used that word, don't use it. And this has been not in mixed company, all black folks, don't use it. I don't like that word, don't use it, period. Right. You know, so if you're going to let it go, let it go. I don't know why the need to hold on to it.
You know? And then we try to regulate, like, yeah. Do you know that white people spend more money on rap music every year than black people?
Wow. Well, there are more white people than there are black people, for one.
Yes.
You know, just.
But it's also very popular. And so on a, I guess you could say a white radio station, like, you know, pop music.
Yeah.
That's, I don't know if it's syndicated, maybe it's local, but had two or three personalities on there. And it's a total white crew. And I'm fine with that. Mm-hmm. And so this woman that was on there, she said, when there's a rap song that I like and it's got the N-word in it, when I'm singing a song, I say the word. She okay. said when she's not singing a rap song, she never uses the word.
Okay, so why is she listening to rap music?
Well, she likes it. She likes it and she likes the music. But I guess this is what I'm saying is, if the author of the song is okay with the word, then she's okay using the word. Mm-hmm. She feels okay, and she should be.
Mm-hmm.
She should be, you know, because you can't control art and confine it behind walls. It appeals to them. It's got to be something about it that they like, whether it's the beat or the style or the poetry of it or whatever it is. So when you made this, I mean, we're all trying to look at each other as just people and human beings, and for this racial thing to go away. And if that's true, then, and it's really just a word, you know, that's how people are adopting it. But I believe her. I totally believe her 100%. For her to admit that on the air, that she says it, I mean, it's part of the song. People aren't going to edit themselves when they're driving in their car in traffic.
Yeah.
You know, and if she admitted that, then also believe what she said, that just in regular conversation, meaning when black people aren't around or in talking to different people, she doesn't use it, because there would be no reason to do that. You know what I'm saying? So
we can't
do it. If we really want people outside our race to stop using that word, then we have to stop. It's kind of a simple formula.
You would think. And that particular lady, it's like, where do you draw the line? And I'm not judging her or anything. I'm going to give a kind of my epiphany moment. This was a while ago, probably 2010 maybe or so. It was a long time ago though.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was the BET Awards or something, or some kind of BET Music Awards or something like that. Well, one of the rappers got on and he was calling women B's and W's and putting it to a nice beat. Mm-hmm. And I just sat back and I looked at it. And I'm like, and there were, you know, the camera does the audience pan and that sort of thing. And I look across the audience to see who's there, see who's dancing, that sort of thing. And it was all these women singing along to the B's and the W's. It's like, wait a minute. Why are you encouraging that? I don't care what the music is. Why are you encouraging that? Why does that appeal? You know, it's so, and I said that to say the lady has to find her line. Where is the line that it's like, you know what? That's just a bridge too far. That's just a step too far. I'm not going to do that. You know, so, and I guess everybody has to come to that point. But I was looking at that, and that that just truly turned me off. It's like, no, I don't want to listen to that anymore. I don't. I'm not going to participate in that anymore.
I try to get people to look at themselves and look at their behavior, because I do that. I want to make sure that I am doing things that are going to promote myself or someone else, or make the community better. Or like one of your communities is like everywhere you go, everyone you interact with, everyone you touch, you know, you can affect them by words that you speak and things that you do.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this is one way of reaching people on here, but another is how we interact with people. Yes. So, you know, people should do that. And I rarely have heard Black preachers talk against it and saying to stop it.
Right.
Stop it. And when you go out and you go back home and you're out on the street and you're talking to your friends on the phone, say, you know what? You're my boy. I really don't want you to use that word anymore when you're talking to me. I stopped using it. And because of the history of the word, I want that to be one thing that we let go. Like, it doesn't cost anything.
Right. That's true.
So much of what we want, we're trying to get bills passed and we want money for this and that. Like, this is something that Black people can control.
Yes. Absolutely. And that's a good point. It doesn't cost anything. And I would expect the preachers to preach from not using that word, to preach from a point of society, of course, but also a preach from a point of the Bible. They're preachers. Their Bible is their, you know, they're shepherding people. So if you can't say, well, no, in society you shouldn't use this as a preacher, then you should be able to present a point of view from the Bible to say, don't use that word. You know, that sort of thing. You know, that word doesn't lift everyone up. It doesn't encourage. It doesn't edify. It doesn't. So, you know, as a preacher, that's what I would expect to hear from them if they don't want to preach from a point of view in society, saying society shouldn't use this word and this is what it means, even though as a preacher, they should be able to do both. But yeah, that's yeah. Interesting. Very, very interesting.
Wrapping up the show now, and thank you everybody for checking us out. Keep coming back. Remember, you can check us on multiple platforms. Spotify people, check us on YouTube. If you're more visual, there is a way for Spotify's getting video now as well. And then YouTubers can check us out on Spotify. Spotify is like uninterrupted, by the way. It like it plays straight through. There's no commercials. There's no, you can block out ads. So there are a few different places to catch us. iTunes is another. And there are a couple more that you want to mention where they can catch the show?
Yes, again, Facebook, like you said, YouTube, Rumble, TikTok. We're on Instagram. We're on Twitter as well. So you can catch us there, links to the show, and follow us on those platforms. So you can talk to us, of course, by email, brutehonestradio@gmail.com. But we also like to hear from you on social media, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, all the social media channels. So we'd like to hear from you there as well. And with that,
so everybody take care and stay warm, and we'll catch you on the next episode.
Have a good one.
Thank you for listening to Brutally Honest Talk Radio. If there's a topic you'd like us to cover, reach out at BruteHonestRadio@gmail.com. That's BRUT, Honest Radio@gmail.com.